Good morning. Singing sounded really good. That sound guy gets here and it just goes great. His name is Mark. He's been around for 183 years. You ever met him before? Where is he? Mark, where are you now? Can you hear me now? Can you hear? Hey, this sound. It needs to be fixed, brother. It needs to be fixed. How many got a prescription sheet? How many got? I asked some people to pass these out, and I'm not sure they did. How many did not receive one? Oh, most. Oh, that's terrible. You know, you ask an elder to do something, and they're just not worth their weight in nothing. I'm telling you something. Dylan, would you come over here for a second? Would you do that? And Noah and Aaron, if you would. I hate to put you on the spot, but I'm gonna. If you'll keep your hand held, because you got to have one of these, it won't do any good to walk away without a prescription today, okay? So hold up your hand real high, and these guys will get them to you. Real high, so I can see you. And while they're doing that, let me just say a couple things. One is college people at the Furby House 405, because we're going to have a good kind of small group and then worship service tonight on Old Bridger Road, and then we're going to watch the Super Bowl together. Same thing for the junior high and high school here at the building, so they think they're starting at 4. And then I understand Saturday, one of the neatest things, and I wish I'd been here like 5 years ago to participate in this, a father-daughter banquet, which is a cool idea. I think that's Charlotte's baby right there. And a lot of parents take advantage of that. Those kinds of things are really cool. Real high so they can see you. Y'all need a prescription before you leave. Everybody needs a prescription. I'm going to do a Randy Carlton, a Carlton this morning. I'm going to do a Carlton. Yeah. I finally get to use my degree maybe in some way. So keep your hands up and they'll get those things to you in due time. In due time, just like we said. All right, Aiden, I'm counting on you now. Got somebody else I'm looking up for up there. You ready? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong. They are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so. Very good. I've never seen so many hands up raised in a Church of Christ in my life. This is cool. Live long enough to see the day. We're in 1 Peter chapter 5. We're going to kind of close out this book. And one of the interesting observations I made this before leaving Kennett and then coming to Jonesboro, it's the same way. It doesn't matter what size community you live in, there are certain businesses you've got to have and plenty of. So Kennett, small area, you got Dunklin County, Pemiscot County, the poorest two counties in Missouri, and we've got 8 banks. How do you explain that? Come to Jonesboro, and you got a bank on every corner. How much money's in Jonesboro? Or is that all owed? I wonder about that. Is that all owed, or do you have it? Well, the other business that we had so much of, we had 7 pharmacies. 10,000 people, 7 pharmacies. And I went to all these pharmacies to see if they're really all that busy. They were going all day long handing out the... How do you explain that many pharmacies? And the reason, I guess, is you watch commercials, everybody's got an ailment, and there's some kind of something out there to treat your ailments. Just watch the commercials, that strange infection under your toe. Have you seen that commercial? And then if you've got an ache in your joints, you have trouble sleeping, if you have high cholesterol, and then there's that little blue pill too, but we won't talk about that. And then there's a pill for everything out there. And if I've got something, surely there's a fix, right? And so everybody runs to the pharmacy to fix the problem they've got. As we close out 1 Peter, I kind of think that Peter got this sense from his readers that there's some real problems, and he wanted his last words written to be the first words they'd remember. To put in a capsule form what he wants them to know that will be most helpful to the dilemmas that they're in. And he wanted the preacher of this text in the future to be like a pharmacist, to explain what you can expect to happen if you take it. How do you take it? When do you take it? What's going to happen? And that's my job. I'm like a pharmacist this morning, right? Get to use my degree and hand out a prescription. Later on, I've got a pen on me. I'll sign it for you, and it'll be worth a quarter on eBay at least. But I have good news and I have bad news. Good news is there's no side effects to this because every commercial creeps me out. Who cares about that little infection under your toe if taking this medication is going to rupture my spleen, eliminate my big toe, and replace my kidney with a tumor? Who cares about the infection under your toe? All this horrible thing. This prescription has no side effects. Bad news. It's a horse pill. It's huge. It's hard to swallow. The rushes from like Fruitland and Jackson. Wow. I'm sorry. I just saw people I haven't seen in a long time. Where was I? Oh, it's a hard pill to swallow. It's like it gets lodged in your throat because it's so large and so difficult to take. And here's the deal. Every one of these in that middle column where you've got prescription, all of them are related in the same way. They require humility. And because of that, we don't want to take it. It's difficult because we want to handle things on our own. We'll get there in just a moment. We're going to go down that first column where it says diagnosis. We're going to look at the problems the text mentions. So if you'll look at verse 5 with me together, actually verse 7 is the first one. Under the problem that you have, under the diagnosis you need to make is this: casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Go ahead to that first one, if you would. Next slide. Next one. Anxiety goes right there under problem. Yes, anxiety goes there. Now, the readers of this book, and the reason that Peter had to write was these people were saying, our faith is costing us something. Our faith is risky in the world we're living in. We're being humiliated, we're being insulted, we're being slandered, and in some cases, actually physically facing some persecution for our faith. And every day, we don't know, are we going to be denied goods and services somewhere? Are we going to be mistreated? Are we going to be humiliated in public by people who don't share our faith? Now, this is not something that you have to face yet for your faith. But you do have anxieties that you have to handle with faith. And the anxieties that we might have might be a little different. Maybe our anxieties are like this. What's wrong with me when I go to the doctor and hear the report on my medical test? What will he say? Maybe it's, I'm raising my kids the best I know how, but I don't know if they're going to adopt the faith or not. Are they going to walk out of the faith forever when they walk out of my house? When am I ever going to meet that person? Who are my kids going to marry? Or maybe it's something different. Maybe it's, I don't know if we'll have enough money for this month or for the end of my life or what. What are the anxieties that you live with? We've got them, and Peter knows it, and the preacher doesn't deny it and just say, let's have wishful thinking and just deny that they are there. No, he says, cast your anxieties. You've got them. I know you've got them. Cast them on the Lord. So anxieties are the first issue. Once you look on past verse 8, and you'll see the second problem that you might face. Be watchful. Be sober-minded. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. There are temptations all around you. And Satan is trying to trap you and trick you and make you fall. Now, if you're not a believer, I've got news for you. Satan really doesn't care all that much about you. He's got you right where he wants you. You don't have to worry so much. There's still temptations out there, but what difference does it make? You're already in his grasp. But once you become a believer, once you confess the name of Jesus, and once you're immersed in the waters of baptism, and once you decide you are a child of God, that's when the war starts. That's when the trouble begins. And he is after you with all his force because he wants you to join with him in judgment. And so Satan's after you. And here's the ingredients. You ready? When the world has a bunch of stuff it offers you, and everybody else is doing it, but your faith says you can't, that's temptation's breeding ground. The world's going to say, we got plenty of this. We offer it to you like a buffet. and everybody else around you is going to be doing this. And it's just fine. And the world says, go for it. You know, do this drug or have sex with them before you get married. And all this, they're offering you all this stuff. And your faith, the only reason you can't participate is because your faith says you shouldn't. If you didn't worry about faith, it wouldn't be a temptation at all. It might be the other side, though. I'll just worry about my own life and I'll not worry about anybody else. Why should I get up on a Sunday morning and go to church? Why should I refrain from doing this? Why should I even worry about the sick and those who are discouraged? Why should I even give a thought to them? I don't have to do that. And the world says, well, don't. Just live your own life. Live it up. You're number one. And the faith says, no, you do have to worry about these things. You do. And so there's your area of temptation. There's a third area I want you to see. Verse 8 again, resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced in the brotherhood around the world. Suffering is the third one. Suffering is when there's some kind of equilibrium in you. Something not quite right. It's not the way it's normally at. So you have your arm like this, it's fine. You break your arm, there's disequilibrium in your arm, and it's suffering. But it's not just physical. It could be emotional. You lose a loved one and the incredible grief that overrides you, and you're not normal. You are not fine. You are suffering. It might be mental, and your thoughts are just not right, and it creates depression in you. It could be spiritual. Anytime you learn something new or let God filter further into your life, it creates suffering. It does. The dilemma's there. Those are the three big problems that the readers that Peter's writing to had, and he knew it, and he names them. And he says, I know that you've got these. Now let me tell you what you can do about them. And I want this to be in a capsule form, nice and simple. Here we go. Go back to this passage again. And you look at verse 7. Back up to verse 6. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Now we enter into humility's solution. I'm going to tell you again, I'm going to tell you one more time, this is the hardest thing in the world because humility says, I can't do this myself. I need help. And no American likes to say that. We want to take care of our own stuff. We want to do it ourselves. I want to watch a YouTube video and take care of business myself. I don't want to have to consult anybody else. But God's solution requires you to say you can't and go outside yourself for help in one of two places. I want you to notice humility's appearance in this passage. Back up to verse 5. Clothe yourselves with humility toward one another. You are going to need God's fellow believers and fellow children to help you. You can't do this without the church. We will continue using Hebrews 10:25, trying to convince people church attendance is important as long as Jesus delays. But you know what? When you finally decide that you need the church, you won't have any problem getting yourself here. It's not that Scripture tells me I have to be with the church. It's not that I should be because everybody's telling me that. Not because Mama raised me this way. It's because I know I need God's people that I'm here. Then we won't have to badger you anymore about church attendance. And you only humble yourself before people that you need. Because people that you don't need, you'll tell off and you'll burn the bridge and you won't worry about it. I learned this, I think, whenever people would come in off the street, come to the church building and say, I need a place to live. And my first question would always be, don't you have family living here? Yeah, my mom lives here, but I don't live the way she wants me to live, and she's preaching at me all the time and I just can't stand it. And my response is always this, it seems to me that if I need some shelter, a roof over my head, I would lower myself and I would just do what Mama says until I could get my own place. That's humility because you need her. Instead, you're marching off and you say, I'll rely on somebody else to support my life because I can't stand my mama or whatever. Humility is this, I need other people. And so the first thing he says, you need each other, but that's not the only one. Look at verse 6, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God. I also need God. So in order to have a solution to your issues, You need God and you need God's people. And we're going to see exactly what that looks like. The first one he says is cast all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. So the prescription is cast those anxieties on God. In other words, pray. Don't hand them off. Handing off is easy. You've got to throw them at God because you're going to want to hang on to them. We want to fret. We want to worry. We want to say to our grandkids, I've been worried about you all month. As if that's a badge of love. I want to be able to say that I just worried and fretted and thought about you all day long. You know what the most faithful thing you can say to your grandkids is? I prayed for you this morning and I haven't thought of you another time. That's true. I prayed. I spent time in my prayer closet with God, and I put everything about you. I've told God everything I'm concerned about you, and I left it there, and I haven't thought of you again all week long. There's faith. It doesn't work like that, though, does it? Casting all your cares on him. This phrase that Peter uses is straight out of Psalm 55. It's a psalm of David about somebody he grew up with at church. They were in the youth group together, and they worshiped together. And then when they got older, they turned on him. He turned on David, and now he's David's greatest enemy. And he's just got David all upset and anxious about things. And God, and David says, I just got to cast it on you, Lord. I'm going to cast my anxieties on you, Lord. And he describes how he does that. He says, morning, noon, and night, I cry out to you to take care of this. Here's what casting it on God means. I'm going to, in the morning, get up and this thing meets me. As soon as my eyes open, this thing meets me. For some of you, it's 3 a.m. and you don't get back to sleep because this anxiety overtakes you and it so overwhelms your mind you can't think of. So at that moment, cry out to God and cast it to him. Don't hand it off. That's not enough. You got to give it a heave-ho like a hot potato and you got to throw it to God and say, God, I can't take this anymore. And the truth is you can't. You can't do a thing about what you're worried about, but God can. And that's what you're saying. I'm going to throw it on God in this morning, but I'm going to tell you something. When you come home for lunch and you have that sandwich and chips, and that one idle moment, it's going to come back. This anxiety is going to come back and it's going to perplex your soul again. And what you got to do is at noon again, cry out to God again and say, God, it's come back. It's come back. So you got to take it again and you got to throw it to him and you go back to work and then you go lay your head on the pillow at night and here it comes crawling back again. Like that neighborhood cat you feed just once. It's gonna come back. And there's not a thing you can do about it. And it's time to decide, do you think God's big enough he can? Do you think that you can just get on your knees and say, God, I can't do a thing about this, but I trust you can. I'm gonna give it to you. I'm gonna cast it to you. I'm gonna throw it to you, and I'm gonna expect you to take care of it. Humility. You'll never get good at prayer until you get good at humility, because prayer is a surrender, a white flag that I can't do this, only God can. And then you won't have any problem getting on your knees talking to God about it. Spend too much time trying to take care of it yourself and you can't do an inkling about it. That's the second thing. That's humility's solution for anxiety. But notice temptation. Keep going in the passage. We're going to go through this passage again. And so he says this. Casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Here comes temptation floating through your life, trying to trip you up and entrap you. What do you do about it? He says, resist him, firm in your faith. Submit to your faith. This is not firm in your faithfulness. Don't read it like that. That's not true. Firm in your faith. Firm that Scripture, the content of what you believe, is what you will do. Because when Satan comes around to tempt us, we want to use our own strategies to defeat him. And that's the history of humanity and sin. Human resources are not real good against a spiritual being like the devil. It's taking the Scripture and saying, I trust that God knows more about me than I know about me. And Scripture gives me this device, this scheme against Satan. We are not ignorant of the devil's schemes. That's true. How many of you know already this week how temptation or what temptations are going to confront you? Raise your hand. Oh. How many of you? I want a show of hands here. How many already know what temptations are going to face you this week? You already know it because they have the last 500,000 weeks of your life. Raise your hand. We're acting like I'm mystified. Wow, I can't believe that. I just went into gossip again, and I've gossiped every week of my life for the last 30 years. How that just totally shocked me. Give me a break. We're not ignorant of the devil's schemes. That's what Scripture says. The problem is we fight with our own devices, and what Scripture says is, why don't you trust God's description? Here's how God would have you handle it. Satan comes after Jesus in the temptations right after his baptism. Where is Jesus when he's tempted by Satan then? Everybody say it together. Wilderness. He's in the wilderness. And he's 40 days fasting, praying, meditating on Scripture. What Scripture is he meditating on? Let's all say it together. You ready? Somebody said prophets. Somebody said Psalms. No. Okay, let's go back and do this again. Where is he when he's being tempted? The wilderness. What is the book, the one book of the Old Testament he quotes three times in defense of himself against Satan, which means he was meditating on this book in the wilderness? What book was it? Deuteronomy, the lessons Moses reviewed with Israel. Here's how you failed. Here's how Satan comes upon you. And here's how you overcome Satan with these temptations so that when you go in the promised land, you won't fall again. Is it interesting? It is interesting, isn't it? Jesus is meditating on lessons learned from wilderness temptation while he's in the wilderness so that when Satan comes, he's ready. Why can't we learn to memorize Scripture too? Don't just memorize any Scripture. Not any Scripture will do. Let's memorize those Scriptures that pertain to the weakness that we have. Are you get into gossip conversations? I've got verses for you. Lust, I've got verses for you. Lying, tearing people down with your speech, I got verses for you. Don't memorize John 11:35 and think that's going to fend off Satan. Jesus wept is true, but it's useless when Satan's after you. I know it's an easy verse to memorize. It's just not very helpful to you. And you learn to accept the fact that God knows you better than you do by doing what Scripture tells us to do. So there's this couple. This couple will go shopping a lot, and they've got their credit cards maxed to the hilt. There's no room left on it. They realize that they have what was called retail therapy addiction. Every time they feel down, they go and they buy something. It makes them feel good for a while, but it doesn't last very long. And they've got their credit card maxed, and so they decide to themselves, and this is true, y'all, they decide to themselves, going to the mall is sin for us. Do you think that could be true? Now, I'm not going to get up and say going to the mall is a sin for all of y'all. And we got to have the maturity to know that for some of us, we have greater weaknesses, and some things are sins for us that are not sins for everybody. This has been a problem for the church all these years because we want to be able to preach one unified message all the time. But let's just face it, there are some things that people struggle with that other people don't. And by the way, this does not mean that when they see me going to the mall, I'm sinning. Let's grow up, church. If it's a weakness for you, limit yourself and don't make me be the excuse for you to fail. Grow up, take responsibility, and do your thing. And so this couple decides going to the mall is a sin for them. Okay, but one day she's invited to a mall with her friends. She says to her husband, I'm going to go to the mall. He says, now, dear, we've decided. I know, and I'm not going to get anything. I promise you, I swear I'm not. No, you don't need to go. You can't handle it. I can handle it, dear. I can handle it. Well, she goes to the mall. When she gets back, she's got two bags in her hand. And he just drops his head. She says, dear, let me explain what happened. We're going through the mall, and I was window shopping. I saw this beautiful summer dress in the store. And I just knew if I went in and tried it on, they wouldn't even have my size. So I went and I tried it on. Oh, my husband would think I look great in this. And he says, why didn't you say, get behind me, Satan? She said, I did. And he said, ooh, looks good from back here too. If Scripture tells you that for you something is wrong. Scripture's right. And if you think you're strong enough to handle it, you're wrong. Trust Scripture's explanation. Trust Scripture's script for you in your life. That's how you handle temptation. What about suffering? This is an interesting one, right? There's this next verse says, and these people suffered, right? After you've suffered a little while, but before you say, resist him standing firm in your faith, verse 9, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced in your, by your brotherhood throughout the world. It's interesting how he says this. Know that there's nothing you're suffering that's unique to you. Others in the brotherhood are undergoing the same kinds of suffering. And so I'm going to argue this. What he's saying is submit to the fellowship. Submit to the fellowship and know that you're not the only one with this. You sit there and you handle this and you think, I can't let it be known because everybody would be ashamed of me. If they know that I'm getting close to divorce, if they know that I'm losing it with my teenage son, they will estrange themselves from me. They will judge me. I won't fit in. I won't belong. And I'll feel weird and I'll feel odd and I can't let it be known. And they start distancing themselves from the church at the very time they need the church the most. It's crazy how we do this to each other. January 1, I think it's okay for me to say this. We had a man come up here and admit he'd been unfaithful to his spouse. And he told us that. Why do you think he did that? Could you imagine walking down an aisle about to tell people one of the most private things you can imagine, and you're going to tell a whole audience of people this? There's only one reason why you'd ever do that. It's when you realize you can't handle this thing by yourself anymore. And the pain of keeping it hidden is so great that the pain of revealing it is less. And you actually test God and say, okay, I'm going to do this. I'm going to share it with a fellowship. I'm going to risk it. I'm going to do one of the most humiliating things I've ever done, and I'm going to share it with a church, and I'm going to trust God that what you say, it doesn't make any sense to me. How in the world is saying this aloud to people and embarrassing myself? How can that possibly be the way to find God's grace? What Scripture says. And he did. Another one after this, another person, another story, said to me, I started sharing this with some ladies at church, and I found out there are more people who've experienced this and been in the same spot as me than I ever thought. I never knew, looking out there on a Sunday morning, there were people who understood this dilemma I'm in. There's more stuff right here in this church that we can help each other with if we will submit our lives to the fellowship. If we will trust enough that I can open my life and I will actually find out, because there are people throughout the brotherhood undergoing the same kinds of suffering I am. The ties are deceiving. The looks on Sunday morning are a little bit lie-based. Our lives are not altogether perfect. But you won't discover that until you submit to fellowship. Now the last column, real quick. I know I'm going long here. What can you expect? That's what I put result on the video projector up there, but it really means prognosis. What can I expect if I actually do this? If I swallow this pill that's very difficult, and I, with humility, actually cast my cares on God, if I, instead of worrying and fretting about them, I cast them on God, what can I expect to happen? And so we go back to that verse, casting your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Look at the verse before. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that the proper time he may lift you up. At due time, he may lift you up. I want you to know this, when you share your anxieties with God, in due time, God will lift you up out of that. In due time. Do you know what in due time is? Do you have due time on your watch? Does anybody have a point to do? No. What is due time? God's time. At the rightest time. It's the rightest time possible. God in due time will lift you up. So do not think that we're saying this morning, cast your cares on God and he's going to fix them all this morning. It's not true. in due time he will. What's interesting, though, is you go back one more verse. Clothe yourselves, all of you, with humility toward one another. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. In due time he will lift you up, but in the meantime he will give you grace. He might say no right now, but even when he says no right now, he gives you grace right now until the due time comes and he lifts you out of it. He gives you a lift in due time and a grace in the meantime. You see this most especially in Jesus. Three times, let this cup pass from me. God says, no, no, no. But I'll tell you what I will do. I will send angels to minister to you in between here and there. You are still going to have some trouble here, but in the meantime, I'm going to give you grace. If you cast it on God. I won't promise anybody, nobody can promise you that there's an end, quick end to your dilemma. I can tell you this. God has the right time waiting for you, and he's going to lift you up out of that. Until then, he's going to give you enough grace to sustain yourself faithfully through that. Second, what about temptation? What happens if I actually stand on my faith, as it says in verse 9? Resist him, standing firm in your faith. You will resist him. You will be able to have resistance against Satan. You're not going to send him away forever. He's going to come back, but you're going to have a resistance. Just like having spraying off. It's just a little short resistance against the mosquitoes. This is a short resistance against Satan if you'll stand firm in your faith. For some of you, like Joseph, it means run. It means get away from that because you know yourself. You know you're not strong right now. Don't even let yourself be in the spot. Run. For some of us, it's memorizing those verses like Jesus that arms us with truth in that time of temptation. And Satan went away, right? Jesus used it as written, Satan went away for a more opportune time. For others, it's avoid every appearance of evil. I'm going to pick on teenagers for a minute, and they're dating here, right? They're dating, and they really like each other. They're really into each other. There's a lot of attraction. There's a lot of chemistry here, right? And so they're on a date, or they're all together, and, oh, mom and dad aren't home yet. All right. Do they go into the house and wait on mom and dad? No. Go to the mall. Go somewhere public. You get in that house with no parents around and you're going to try stuff. And your parents are going to look at you when you're telling them this and say, they're going to say to you, parents, get ready for this. Don't you trust me? You ready for the answer? No way! There ain't no way I'm trusting you. Live by what Scripture says. Sometimes you run, sometimes you stay and fight with Scripture, and sometimes you don't even go there. You avoid every appearance of evil. There are mechanisms in Scripture that are already in place that God says, I want you to discern what you need to do at this moment to resist this temptation. And if you do that, you will resist Satan. Last one, you're suffering. You share that suffering with other people in the fellowship. What can you expect to happen? When you take this medication, this humility medication, what can you expect? Resist him, firm in your faith, verse 9, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced in the brotherhood throughout the world. And after you've suffered a little while, it's not going to be immediate. Don't let any preacher tell you it's going to be immediate or, you know, a miraculous or instant deliverance. God just wants you to suffer a little while. That's the God we serve. And if we're going to be a spokesman for him, we need to tell the truth. You will suffer a little while, but after that, the God of all grace, who's called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. God will restore you. He will do it in his time after you've suffered for a little while. Because there's something in it for you, and there's something in it for him. Let me close out with Colossians chapter 1. If you have your Bibles, turn to Colossians. Chapter 1, and I think it describes you. I think this is you. This is what you want. And so, for Colossians chapter 1, verse 9, from the day we heard, we have not ceased to pray for you. So Paul is praying for these Colossian believers, asking that you may be filled to all the knowledge of his will and all spiritual wisdom and understanding. He says, I'm assuming that you want to be full of the knowledge of God. Is that you? Is that everybody in here? I assume so. so that you can walk in a manner worthy of the Lord. Is that something you desire, to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord? I'm assuming so. That you may be fully pleasing to Him. Does everybody in here desire most of all this week to be fully pleasing to Him? I hope so. He then gives like a colon, four participial phrases that describes what a manner worthy of the Lord and a pleasing way is. Four things. You ready for them? Number one, bearing fruit in good works. Go out there and do good works that bears fruit. Number two, increasing in the knowledge of God. So the more you know about God, the more pleasing you become, and more you can walk in a manner worthy. And we're going to skip number four and go to number three. I mean, I'm just saying, I'm not going to get to number four. I know the numbers. You may be strengthened with all power according to His glorious might. I want you to be strengthened with all God's power according to His glorious might, so that you can do amazing miracles and rise above all the troubles of life, and everybody can look and say, that's a great life of God. No. You be filled with all His might, so that what? For all endurance and patience with joy. In a world that longs to see miracles, God's not impressed or pleased with miracles. God is pleased and impressed when His faithful people go through suffering with patience and endurance with joy. If you will learn to embrace suffering and just say, this is part of my, and I'm gonna endure this with faith and joy, God says, that pleases me. That's a life worthy of me. And that's what He's striving to get us to understand. There's your prescription. Everything's filled. I'm telling you, anything happening in your life that just gets you feeling amiss or depressed, I promise you, somehow comes back to one of those three things. And now you have this prescription that you can actually use. But here's two things I don't want you to do. I don't want you to go home and kind of put a magnet on, magnetize it to your refrigerator, or put it in a drawer somewhere and forget about it. And just handle everything just like you always have. I want you to go home, and I want you to keep this out in full view. And this may not apply to you right now. Things are hunky-dory with you right now, and you're not even thinking about these problems. That's fine. Wait a week. Wait a week. Some of this stuff will be relevant. And when it is, I don't want to be like going to somebody's house and I see a prescription they have on their refrigerator they never filled. Did it cost too much? This is free, y'all. Is it a big pill that's hard to take? Yes. And maybe you don't want to take it, but I want to tell you, this is God's prescription for you. And it really will bring about the deliverance you're looking for, but you have to be willing to take it. So suck it up, get rid of yourself, lower yourself, be humble, and take God's prescription. And just see if He's not exactly faithful to His word like He says He is. This is only a promise for those who are His faithful children. If you're not a child of God this morning, I want you to know none of this makes any sense. Nothing we've done this morning matters at all, because you are not a child of God. If this is something you strive for, this is something you long for in your life, this is available. This is like a insider privileges, right? Membership has its benefits. If you've never become a child of God, just name the name of Jesus from your lips, repent of your sin, and be immersed in the waters of baptism. And when that happens, you become a child of God and all the blessings and challenges that come with it. This morning, if this is something you're subject to, we'd like nothing more than to see you humble yourself and come into the presence of God's people and say His name from His lips, just like every believer in here has done and continues to do. You need to do this? Now's a great time as we stand and sing to encourage you.
Break my heart, dear.